important aspects is looking for new drugs, new vaccines, and the work is on these aspects by Indian researchers, Indian scientists, private players, companies as well. And there are some very interesting and positive results as well coming our way. One important ingredient of this particular aspect is the fact that there will have to be regulatory clearances, and there is a regulatory mechanism in place. Today, we are going to talk about how this regulatory mechanism works and how this can be further made more, significant or more seamless in terms of bringing it to the global standards as well as bringing some reforms, if at all they are required. And for this, we joined by a distinguished panel of guests. Let me first introduce them to you, beginning with, we have Dr. V.G. Somani. He is the Drug Controller General of India. We also have with us Professor Y.K. Gupta, a well-known pharmacologist and a former dean and head of pharmacology in All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And we're also joined by an industry representative here, Mr. Pankaj Patel. He's the chairman of Zydus Cadila, sorry. And welcome, all of you gentlemen. Let me begin with you, Professor Gupta. Let's start by understanding the regulatory framework or regulatory mechanism which is in place in our country right now.
I think, Vishal, you have raised the question of a regulatory framework in India. And I must tell you one thing. What is the purpose of the regulatory framework is as follows. The purpose is to make the new drug, new regime, new therapy available to the citizen of India as fast as possible, but keeping the safety of the patient or safety of the people of India at the top of that. And therefore, I consider that the Indian regulators are now in the COVID scenario are responding like a warrior, like a people who like to do their work as fast as possible. Now, I see the change in last, I would say, 6 months, and particularly last 3-4 months, a tremendous change with the speed and the quality of the work. We have now 107 clinical trials going in India on the COVID only, which means that the new drugs, either they are repositioned or the new molecules or new regime, whether you talk of remdesivir, whether you talk of hydroxychloroquine, or whether you talk of plasma therapy, or you talk of sanitizers, I think the drug controller are responding in an astonishingly fast manner, which is the need of the day. Okay. How I would say there is always demand from academicians, from industry, from the public, more and more. And that is why there will be always something when me, Pankaj Bhai, would be talking about ki ye bhi hona chahiye, ye bhi hona chahiye, itna fast hona chahiye. But I appreciate them that within the limited time, within the limited capability, we are fastest what can be happening.
Okay.
So, say we have to balance between the safety, between the availability of the drug, how fast, and between the scientist, between the consumer, the regulator's role is like a pivotal, which can be very balancing.
Okay, definitely. That's a very important aspect out there. There has to be a very fine balance between the speed and the quality as well. Let me first bring in Dr. Somani here before I bring in the industry perspective from Mr. Patel. Dr. Somani, your views on the regulatory framework or the regulatory mechanism which is there. And obviously, as Professor Gupta is saying, that in the past few weeks or months, we've seen that the speed is something which is obviously, on a very positive note for all stakeholders in this entire system.
See, thank you very much for inviting for this program. The regulatory mechanism is, or whatever science or whatever trial, they are mainly meant for solving the problems of the consumers, patients, and the stakeholders. They are not for the sake of just regulating something. If the problem is of the peacetime, you have to respond like a peacetime. if the problem is of a pandemic time, you have to respond like a pandemic time. And that is what is the regulator's job is, to see that the medicines, investigational products, vaccines, prophylactic products, and ancillary aid products are with a safe and effective quality are available to the public after going through the series of regulatory checks, which we call as either clinical trial or testing or laboratory testing or GMP inspection or GLP inspection. Thereafter, they are available to the public.
Mm-hmm.
How deep to go into it? Where we call it as an essential regulation and where we call it as a nice to have regulation? That depends on, you know, how you scientifically look at the things. So that approach is called as a risk-based approach, need-based approach. And India is in constant touch with most of the Western and Eastern regulator. I personally, I'm a chairman of 194 countries, member state mechanism of the World Health Organization on the panel of substandard and falsified medicine. So all the regulator and the diplomatic leadership comes over there. They listen to approaches taken by the India very carefully, and they take the cognizance of it because India supplies to 40% of the globe, including the Western world. 195 countries medicines and our vaccines goes. Entire supply chain of 40% of the world is dependent on India. Because 16% we ourselves are. So we have tried to make our regulatory system a properly balanced, not exactly copying what US is doing or not exactly copying what EU is doing or what exactly copying what Japan is doing. We have our regulation, which are really essential, whether it is for the manufacturing, whether it is for the clinical, and sometimes clinical trials, or whether it is, sometimes we are much ahead than the Westerners because of the local conditions. For example, Dr. Gupta will agree with me, in the clinical trials and new drugs approvals, we are the fastest, we have made the fastest new drug clinical trial and regulatory framework. But in that, some of the things in the patient safety, we have included the mechanism for ensuring the compensation by the regulators.
Mm-hmm.
To take care of the subject, participant, and because, you know, there are people who may not be having so much of knowledge, who will take care of them? And they cannot go for a class action for themselves into the court, or they cannot also, go even to the consumer courts. For them, the regulator will stand by them. But it doesn't mean that regulator will act as a hurdle for the research. Ethical research, quality research, ethical production, quality production with a consumer protection and taking all stakeholders into consideration and consultation and taking a risk-based approach and the best approach. That's how on 1st, 19th March, there was not a single trial going on the COVID. On 19th March, there was not a single testing kit available in India. From 19th March till date, we have worked day and night conducting so many committee meetings on the Skype, more than 200 committee meetings, more than so much of assessment in the laboratory inspection. And today we have 225 testing kits available, 225 suppliers, manufacturers and importers of testing kit available in India,
mm-hmm.
just within 70 days. And as Dr. Gupta said, we have 107 trial going on, starting from, you know, any kind of, whether it is a immunological product, vaccine product, prophylactic product, repurposed drug, convalescent plasma, stem cells, and you name anything, and the actual data will come from our country. So that's how we are working. Thank you.
Okay. That's a very, apt summary. And those 90 days which you mentioned about starting from 19th of March till today, obviously I've seen a lot of work being done by all stakeholders, researchers, scientists, regulatory authorities, private companies as well. Let's bring in the industry perspective here. Mr. Pankaj Patel, your company is involved in a lot of research as well, development of drugs and vaccines as well, and you have a long standing experience with the Indian regulatory framework also. How do you view, or how does the industry view, the regulatory framework which is in position right now, and the work which has been done in the last 90 odd days by the regulatory authorities in terms of making it fast, quick, as well as ensuring the quality?
I think first of all, I will echo what Professor Gupta has said, is that in the last post-COVID scenario, our regulators have worked at a very jet speed, I would say, to make sure that everything what is required to be done is done in a shortest possible time, without compromising on the certain very essential part of the regulatory process, which is very encouraging. The question comes to everybody's mind that COVID is here, but someday it will go. But what we learned out of COVID, can that be a kind of a regular practice? That is the way I would see that the next things to happen. Mm-hmm. But if I see from a long-term perspective, there are five things which I believe are important. First is the whole complexity involved in regulatory process, as it has happened during this time, should be now become a new normal. And that's why the regulatory process has to be revised in a way that whatever we have learned out of COVID and whatever is relevant, we can implement. I think Government of India has already formed two committees which are seized of it and working on it. The second point is the review process also has to improve. So online review by more capable people, having a better expert committee and things like that were to happen so that we meet the global standards, which is called ICH standards. The third is that we have to increase the capacity and capability of the regulator. Mm-hmm. Capacity from a perspective that we have limited staff and limited resources available with the regulator. So we need to really strengthen that regulatory manpower, number one. And second is that also some infrastructure might be necessary to do it online, do it more lab testing, quicker testing, and so on and so forth. The fourth thing is that why we are doing this, there has to be more transparency, which is the need of the hour. And if we implement the digital gateway and through digital process with transparency, can also be achieved very clearly. And the last is that while we are doing this, what is going to be very important, that this difficult time of COVID, research or innovation has become a very important part. Mm-hmm. And that's why it is required that currently, because of historical reason, number of things where regulators are involved, not only DCGI but others, in terms of approving research projects from the beginning till we reach to human clinical trial. Mm-hmm. Globally, nowhere in the world, regulators get involved till we reach the human clinical trial. So okay. I think there is a need to really see that regulatory process can be simplified so that only when we reach to human clinical trial, it's a time when regulatory approvals process should get involved, balance, the scientist and the research institute should be encouraged to do more research, more experiment to make sure that we have more and new innovative remedies available for our people.
Okay. Those are very significant suggestions, Mr. Patel. Thank you so much. And I'd like to bring in Dr. Somani on this. For all these aspects, as Mr. Patel has pointed out, Mr. Somani, revising the review process of the complexity involved, enhancing the capacity or capability, but most important is the approval for research projects as well. That's a very significant suggestion coming in there from the industry. How can we move ahead on these, Dr. Somani?
This is a really very important suggestion that while in the beginning stages of the research, our CSIR, IITs or any research private institute or the industry, they should feel encouraged. They should not be subjected to various kinds of, whether it is online or offline, multiple window or single window, they should not be subjected to any kind of windows with regards to permissions and with regards to going ahead is concerned. Mm-hmm. Only thing is that they should be able to prove the funding agency that they are coming they are able to do something which has a deliverables in it. That is a very good suggestion. Till such time it comes to the human clinical trial. And after human clinical trial, since the subjects and participants are involved, it should be properly regulated so as to see the safety and efficacy. And for that, whatever review process, infrastructure building, definitely if you see, if you compare US FDA with our FDA, US FDA is, having a population which is, much lesser than us. Mm-hmm. But they are having a 15,000 manpower with them of their own. And we combinedly, we at CDSU are having 5,000 and rest of the, not 5,000, 500 technical manpower plus 300 in the laboratories. And similar is the case in the state government. There must be 1,000 people in the inspectorates and 500 in the laboratory. So most we are hardly 2,000, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, a country of 130 billion, our manpower, if we see, our infrastructure, if we see, this is, and then the pool of experts who can make the research protocol, who can make the appropriate, who can understand the appropriate research protocol, then the pool of people who can train these people, who can make the protocols or who should conduct the research, that is also lacking. So this simultaneous development is also needed. This is little bit different than the regulatory framework, isn't it? But only if we see the regulatory framework, mm-hmm. at the regulatory framework, there is no other go than to become the world's best. Because we will be, today we are pharmacy for the 40% of the world. I'm sure within by 2025, we will be the pharmacy for the 70% of the world. And not only we just having the word pharmacy is not sufficient. We should be quality and organized pharmacy of the world.
Okay.
Every and affordable, quality, organized, affordable and accessible pharmacy of the world. And that's how our regulatory mechanism will have to be strengthened pre-clinical, before it comes to the clinical research, we will have to really simplify the processes, as Dr. Pankaj ji said and Dr. Gupta ji said, and that we believe in, and we have to become the best in the world, and the standards are as per in line with the international practices. We have done that in the new drugs and clinical trial. We have done that in the medical devices. And we are moving towards it. Now, development of capabilities, capacities, better reviews, training, this process should speed up. Thank you.
Okay. Professor Gupta, your views on those suggestions, and as Dr. Somani pointed out, the way they can be implemented, the suggestions which came in from Mr. Patel here, the industry representative. Would you like to add on anything, or the way these can
I
be done?
Yeah, I would respond to your first question that how we handle the research projects, because I have been reviewing the research projects submitted to ICMR, DST, DBT, BIREC, SERB, and we have a specific calls for COVID-related projects.
Mm-hmm.
In ICMR, where I am chairing the committee which is reviewing the projects submitted, more than 400 we have reviewed, and we found many are interesting, but majority of them are requiring refinement. So what is important, what Somani ji and I also said, there is a need for training of academicians in GCP, good clinical practice, GLP, good laboratory practice, GMP, and also sensitizing them to regulatory policies. So that when they start the research, they also have in backup of their mind that what data and how the data will be required, which will be useful later on. That's number one.
Okay.
Number two, as far as drug regulation is concerned, the need of the day is the policies should be science-driven. Very correctly, we have a large pool of experts. But I would say maybe after 1 year or 2 year, which our Pankaj Bhai said, that what we learned from this, every question, every statement of OECD or WHO should become a question. Mm-hmm. We should ask why we need 50 animals, why we need rat, cat and mouse, all the three. Can this be done in two? The purpose is simplification without losing any safety concern. Can okay. we use alternate animals also for safety? Can we generate the capacity of the animal toxicity in India more so that we do not go out of India for doing just capacity building, just for getting testing done in dog and cat, which mm-hmm. is becoming difficult but required by regulatory process? Is it a must? If it is a must, why should not we have capacity in India? Why should the drug development get delayed just because of that? Mm-hmm. The clinical trial, when you do it, should be as simple as possible rather than as complex, as very difficult to understand by expert like me. And that's what yes. myself and Somani ji also always say, that we must make the regulation as simple as understandable to lay person.
Okay.
Today, incidentally, the regulations are such that you have to have an expert to understand it. Even expert will require another expert to decipher what does it mean.
Okay.
And last 2 years, in fact, I was chairing the GCP revision committee and the new regulations committee. And our main emphasis is be practical, be India-centric, be as simple as possible. Lastly, okay. I would say in India, what is lacking and what is most important is academia, industry and the regulatory disconnect must be bridged.
Mm-hmm.
Idea which generates from academic institution should be taken up with industry. The industry which it has a pool of expertise should also flow to the academic institution. Both should have interaction with the regulator, so that what we happens, we go to the regulator at the end and then regulatory expert will say, yeah, this is not there, this is not there, why not? This should be included in the beginning of the discussion.
Okay.
Though pre-IND meetings have been, but I think this is a very good things which are flowing now. And okay. committees have been made. Pankaj Bhai is heading that core committee. I am also, and Somani is also a member of that. So we are in a very positive direction for that.
Okay. That's a very interesting point out there, Professor Gupta. And I'd like to bring in Mr. Patel on that. You know, bridging that gap between academia and the industry as well, ensuring that the research and innovation has a free flow. And the overall concept of making the regulations simple, practical, and India-centric, as Professor Gupta said. Mr. Patel, the roadmap from here onwards.
So I think it's a very... I think the point is that currently there are no coordination happening between academia and industry, academia and research, government research labs. And I think there is a need to create a platform. And this is all called for an ecosystem which is supportive to do innovation. Mm-hmm. And I think the way we appraise people, the way we monitor their performance should be such that these kind of initiatives are increased much more. Industry would always have a vested interest to get into this because they get product out of it and they can ultimately commercialize it, make sales and profits. So industry will be always very keen to make that happen, but it's not happening as it should have happened. And why it is not happening? Currently, we are all studying it, but we know that there are, basically we need to create a kind of a win-win alliances for people. One of the important things is that if I'm working in a research lab or if I'm working in a university, if I come across something and I develop a product or a project, I should be allowed to work in that institute, at the same time float a company to commercialize it. And then I can really get funding and things to happen. In that industry may also come in at some stage and then acquire that company and things happen. That is what we see happening in the Western world, and similar kind of environment should happen in India as well. Now, we know that some of them could be a government servant. They have learned and done things because of their job being there. But at the same time, making them incentivizing by this way, we would actually encourage many, many people to do lot many things. I think there is no dearth of talent. India has enough talent. If you go to Western world, any research laboratory, 30 to 40% scientists working there are of Indian origin, graduating from our great institutes. So the question would be here is very, very clear for us. How do we encourage our scientists to make this happen?
Okay.
The second part is Dr. Gupta talked about the science. I think ultimately we are in this medicine is a business, is science. Mm-hmm. It's very science based, and anything what we do has to have a strong and rational scientific approach to make that happen. Because ultimately we want drugs, but we want safe drugs and we want efficacious drug, and that is very important. And that's why stronger regulators are important. Unwanted regulation should be removed, and that's the way the motto should be, so that we have quality product available, we can supply to our people and also people throughout the world.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Patel out there, and Professor Gupta, as well as Dr. Somani, for sharing your views and valuable time with us on this very important aspect. As all of our panelists pointed out, it is all about ensuring safety and efficacy as well. But the regulator has to be strong, not unwanted, as the industry representative said. And there are several aspects to it. Obviously, the capacities and capabilities of the regulatory authorities will also have to be enhanced much further. And the overall theme can be simple, practical, and India-centric. We'll come back again tomorrow with a different topic. Till then, you keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.